Yo, what's good YouTube, man? It's Gary Rodin on Fan TV, man. Back at another video. Like the content of this video, go ahead and smash that like button. Like the content of this channel, go ahead and subscribe, man. Look, so we are going to talk about some Ravens trade candidates today, what they need to add to this team. And the trade deadline is officially 3 weeks away as of today. Trade deadline is October 31st at 4 p.m. So 3 weeks to the trade deadline. But what I want to do first is I want to kind of wrap up the Steelers game real quick. I'll talk about a couple of things that has been said the last couple of days. All right, so first thing is, I feel like it's a little bit of an overreaction to the wide receiver room. All right, now listen, I am very, very disappointed by how the receivers play, how they caught the ball, things like that. But if we watch the game again, guys are running open. They're wide open down the field. They just got to catch the football. All right, that's the first thing. All right, second thing is, I'm hearing a lot about this whole rugby ball situation thing. Listen, I could care less about the Ravens receivers coaches have them catching rugby balls. Listen, when wide receivers train in the offseason, they catch tennis ball, they catch all kinds of things. There are stories of Jerry Rice, great receiver all time. You know how he said he got his hands? I think his father was a bricklayer and used to throw him bricks or something like that, all right? Listen, wide receivers do all kinds of unconventional things to learn how to catch the ball better, okay? When the Ravens had zero drops heading into this Week 5 game versus the Steelers, I didn't hear a peep about this rugby ball. I didn't even know the Ravens were training with a rugby ball until this story came up on ESPN and I heard other people being upset about it. It's a complete and absolutely non-story. It's not important. It's not why the Ravens receivers dropped the ball. They dropped the ball because they had a bad day. Now, though, that bad day can't become a second, third, fourth bad day. It has to be a one-and-done scenario, and we move on from there. All right, so I don't want to hear about a rugby ball. Okay. And lastly, right, do the Ravens need to trade for a wide receiver? This is my answer to this. My answer is no. I think the Ravens have the wide receiver room that they need. Okay, and here's why, right? To me, the Ravens are still figuring out where they need to go. And as we come into week six now, actually week five just passed. To me, they need to have set positions so everybody can get the groove of the offense, all right? I think Bateman, I kind of talked about this in the conversation yesterday, right, with some of you guys. So Bateman needs to line up at the X. The left or right doesn't matter. Just have him on the X as that lone outside receiver. Odell needs to be a primarily slot guy. That's where he's at right now at this point in his career and his recovery process from his injury. He needs to work the slot, use your veteran craft, work on these corners. Got two-way goals inside, outside, which way he can break. That's what he needs to work at. And then you have Zay Flowers as your chess piece that you can move all over the field, right? Line him up in the backfield, have him come in motion, left, right, whatever, right? That's what the Ravens kind of need to do is get the wide receivers kind of set in place where they know what they're going to be at and get the offensive rhythm from there. All right. That's my opinion on the wide receiver room. I think it's a little bit of reaction saying, well, what are the Ravens going to do now? There are no weapons for now for Lamar Jackson, things like that. This is the best wide receiver room Lamar has ever played with, and not saying that means it's the greatest wide receiver room. Obviously, it doesn't mean that. All right. There are teams with better wide receivers. Do I think the Ravens need to make a trade for, you know, a guy like Davante Adams, Jerry Jeudy, Courtland Sutton? Those guys would be great. And if the Ravens make that trade, I'm not going to be upset about it. I won't say that it was pointless, needless, things like that. I won't say that, right? Because those are good receivers. My thing is, I think they don't need to make that trade. That's all I'm saying. It's one bad game from the wide receiver core. I can't hop out there and say, we got an issue. Because the first four games of the year, we weren't talking about the Ravens had an issue with the wide receiver room, right? At least that's not what I was talking about. I was talking about going conservative in the second half. I was talking about, hey, push the ball down the field some more, things like that. It wasn't the wide receivers aren't getting open. It wasn't, we just don't have any guys out there winning. No, the Ravens receivers are winning. The play designs are open for them to catch the football. Last week was just a tragic time. They did not catch the ball. All right, so listen, that's my little rant, wrapping up the Steelers game, talking about the wide receiver room, all right? Now, let's get to today's topic, okay? Trade candidates. When I look at this Ravens team, the glaring weakness is when the Ravens can set up their defense, you know, it's first, second, third quarter, beginning of the fourth quarter, they can send these fancy kind of blitzes that Mike McDonald loves to draw up, and they work effectively. You know, sending your corner, sending Roquan or Patrick Queen on a blitz, you know, faking the blitz with those two guys, and sending somebody else, right? When they can't do that, when it comes to clutch time, crunch time situations, and it's more of a base shell kind of defense, the Ravens simply cannot win with a four-man pass rush, right? It hasn't really been happening. Now, the sole guy that's been winning and winning on multiple occasions is Jadeveon Clowney. Jadeveon Clowney, what I've said this many times, and I'm not joking when I say this. I really believe he will lead the NFL in sacks if he turned his pressures into sacks. So it's too many times he gets his hands on the quarterback, quarterback slips away, and, you know, it's not a sack at that point, obviously. So that's the biggest thing with him, right? So I like what Jadeveon Clowney is doing. We also got to remember Jadeveon Clowney is an older player, right? So the Ravens shouldn't depend on him solely for the pass rush. Odafeola and David Ojabo are both injured, right? So when I look at this team, and this is not just an issue this year, this is going past years as well. When I look at this team, a standout superstar pass rusher is what the Ravens need to acquire, or at least attempt to acquire, right? The Ravens saw a weakness last year sitting next to Patrick Queen at linebacker. They went out and got Roquan Smith. They need a kind of another Roquan Smith-X kind of move to happen this season to take the defense to another level, to where they can close out games without having to blitz, right? Because that's really the main issue here. All right, so listen, when I look around the league, I see a couple of guys and I see a couple of things, right? But what I also want to talk about is the fact that I know the Ravens have had trouble with or been against giving up their picks, but the second round for the Ravens has not been a very, very kind zone for them to draft guys in, right? So when I look at, you traded the second round pick this year to get Roquan Smith, that's kind of what I'm looking for again, right? I went back. I looked at the Ravens' second-round picks for the last 10 years. I'll put it on the screen. So you start in 2013, you got Arthur Brown, 2014, Timmy Jernigan, 2015, Max Williams, 2016, Kamale Correa, 2017, Tyus Bowser, 2018, 2019. They don't have a pick because that's what they traded to get back into the first round to get Lamar Jackson, right? 2020, J.K. Dobbins. 2021, they don't have a draft pick. They traded away Orlando Brown, got a second first-round pick, and then traded away their second-round pick that year. That's when they drafted Bateman and Owe in the first round, all right? Then last year, David Ojabo has been able to stay on the field. So if I look at these list of players, I see Tyus Bowser and I see Timmy Jernigan as two players that play pretty well for the Ravens. Tyus Bowser really well, and Timmy Jernigan had moments, right? You know, I love Dobbins. I love Ojabo as far as their as prospects and players, but injuries have kept them off the field, and that's just the truth about it, right? I mean, you know, we can't make it up. The injuries have kept them off the field, right? All right, and then obviously Lamar Jackson, I'm not counting him in this because he was a first-round pick, even though it is a great move that, you know, you didn't get any second-round picks those 2 years, but you got a superstar franchise quarterback. That's a great move, right? But point being is the Ravens' history in the second round has not been pretty. So I will let go of that second round pick again this year to get one of these pass rushers that I'm about to mention. All right. Now I got three guys here. I'm going to go from the top of the list to the bottom. Now the last guy is not like a consolation prize or nothing, but it's just, you know, one to three. That's how I'm doing it. So number one right here, Brian Burns, outside linebacker, defensive end for the Carolina Panthers, all right? So he's 25 years old. He's on his fifth-year option right now. He doesn't have a deal. He's a free agent next year, and Carolina is 0-5, right? Now, the point with Carolina being 0-5, they don't have their first-round pick next year, right? They traded it to get Bryce Young and a whole bunch of other things, trade with DJ Moore. We know the scenario, right? Carolina's 0-5. They need more trade assets. A second-round pick and some other things might be able to get Brian Burns here, because they could potentially lose Brian Burns for nothing if they don't sign him back, right? So Brian Burns is number one. Number two, Chase Young, right? 24 years old. The Commanders are 2-3. And listen, with Chase Young, there's kind of been a thing where, like, there's been a little bit of tension between him and the Commanders over, you know, the injury history that he has. He started off great. Like, he looked like he's ready to, his rookie year, like he's ready to be all-time great. Kind of slowed down a little bit since then. And that's where we're kind of at with Chase Young right now, right? So, and also with the Commanders, they declined his fifth-year option, right? So when a team does that, you might tend to think a guy's available. You know, we kind of, Ravens are going through that right now with Patrick Queen. Now, I don't think Patrick Queen's available, right? But different teams do different things, right? So it all depends on how you read the situation, right? So Chase Young could be in line for a contract, you know, big contract next year for the Commanders. Or they could be saying, hey, look, man, you know, we're willing to part ways. So it's worth at least an attempt to see if you can get Chase Young. All right. And then the last guy down here is, and maybe the most, when I say reasonable, I mean the guy that I think you Ravens really could get the easiest out of these three people is Danielle Hunter from the Vikings, right? You talked about Danielle Hunter in the offseason. Could the Ravens make a move for him? the Vikings end up signing Danielle Hunter to a one-year deal. He's currently 28 years old. And listen, the Vikings are 1-4. They could be in for, you know, a fire sale type of thing where they're getting rid of players to kind of start a rebuild, right? Justin Jefferson just got hurt. You know, hurt my fantasy team. But Justin Jefferson just got hurt. But on the series, he just got hurt. He's going to be on IR for the next four games, right? You know, their schedule's not getting easier for them, okay? So that's one thing. Kirk Cousins, I believe, is a free agent next year. And also, they could just be at the end of the line with this whole Kirk Cousins at the quarterback experience. It's been several years now, right? They paid Kirk Cousins multiple times at this point. It's a new regime in Minnesota. They could move on from him. And then you got a guy like Danielle Hunter. Same thing. One-year deal. Would the Vikings rather get something in exchange for him or lose him for nothing, right? So when I look at these three guys, these are three potential things that the Ravens could do that will help this team vastly close out games, right? When I look at the Ravens defense, right, so I think the defensive line is okay, honestly. It's okay. It's kind of like a defensive line by committee kind of thing, all right? When I look at the linebacker core, I love what I see. When I look at the secondary, pretty much I like what I see in the secondary, and the safeties are really, really good, all right? For the Ravens to be an elite defense when it comes to closing out football games, you got to have a guy that's going to win on the edge, right? If you look at the best teams in the league, teams that go to the Super Bowl, teams that win Super Bowl, right? Kansas City Chiefs, they got Chris Jones. The Eagles that was in the Super Bowl, they had a rotation of guys. But, you know, you had Javon Hargrave. You got Sweat. They had a whole bunch of guys. Brandon Graham, all right? They had a bunch of guys on Eagles defense, all right? Now they got Jalen Carter, okay? So you need a rotation of guys. 49ers have Nick Bosa. Dallas Cowboys, who have been one of the best defenses in the league. Obviously, they got blown out by the 49ers, but still have been one of the best defenses in the league. They have Michael Parsons. The Ravens are missing that superstar edge rusher that can really close out and finish out games for them right now. If the Ravens can find that guy, hell, we just saw it. Going back to the Steelers game, we just saw it. T.J. Watt, Alex Highsmith. When you look at the end of the game, who closed the game out for the Steelers? It was those two guys, right? T.J. Watt, sacks. Alex Highsmith, strip fumble on Lamar Jackson. So when I look at the Ravens team, this is the last and final piece to this defense. And I think the offense is coming along nicely. If they catch the ball, we're talking about a blowout win in Pittsburgh, right? The Ravens have put up, I don't know, 28, 30 points on the Steelers in a blowout effort. And we're not having this conversation about why he was catching rugby balls. We're not having that conversation, okay? But anyway, if the Ravens can find a way to make another deal like they did for Roquan Smith, but this time for an elite edge rusher, this team is well on their way to being one of the best in the AFC. And hell, they even take it even farther than that. But anyway, let me know your thoughts in the comments, man. I reply to all comments pretty much. So I'm going to get out of here. It's Gabriel, because I'm the Fan TV. I'm out.